Hello everyone. So all the index is in paper 1 giving you sleepless nights. Hopefully this video should help you a little to get a bird's eye view over all indices. So the objective of this video is not to discuss the specific treatments and adjustments in indices. We are going to cover around 27 of them in a very short span of time. The objective is to give you a bird's eye view, and hence this video is going to be hopefully particularly helpful to students who are giving their exams in their last week of preparation, or students who have done their first revision and are sitting for the second revision and want to kind of quickly brush around everything that is around them. Obviously we will be discussing slightly fast, but probably knowing your capability these days, even no matter how fast we go, you'll probably still view this at 1.5 or 2x. Well, if you find it to be a little more faster than what you can digest, you can obviously reduce the speed of viewing as well. But knowing you guys, you would be a little more faster than no matter how fast I go. Nevertheless, chalo, let's get started. So how are we going to go around this? We are covering every topic except for these financial instruments, business combination and consolidation. Other than that, all indices will be covered. There's an old video which is there on this on a similar lines as well, but it has some older standards like revenue under the older contract and old leases, and hence a lot of students mentioned that they want an updated version, and let me try my best to do justice for it. So how are we going to go ahead? I've given each standards. This is in the sequence of the ICAI material, so I'm not kind of, so when you're revising, if you have the ICAI material in front of you, you will exactly know what is coming after what, and hence this is in the sequence of the ICAI material. Secondly, what I've used over here is the unit overview section from the ICAI material. The objective of this this PDF or these notes is not really to kind of give you a one page overview or anything. No, it is not from our FR shield or not a notes that I have compiled. It is from the unit overview. So it is there in your ICAI material. If you want to refer it, you can kind of refer your ICAI material. You don't need this PDF separately. It is for something where probably we can have something on the screen and you don't have to just see me while you are revising this video. Okay, so let's get started. So we will start with every index in the sequence of the ICAI material. Average, each index would take around 2 to 3 minutes. Probably something which is easier like index 1 will take lesser time. Something which is more difficult like leases or revenue might take slightly more time. But we'll try to be as prudent with the time as possible. Chalo, let's get started. So first of all, we have index 1. Index 1 requires the financial statements which comprise of the balance sheet, profit and loss, which includes the statement of other comprehensive income, the statement of changes in equity, and the cash flow statement along with the notes to accounts. There are a few basic principles with the standard mentions, and more important like accrual, going concern, matching concept, consistency, etc. And the more important part of the standard surrounds the current assets and non-current assets. Usually current assets are defined as, or current items are defined as items which get realized within a span of 12 months or operating cycle, whichever is longer. Non-current are items which are other than current. A particular point which involves the breach of a long-term loan condition is particularly important over here. So if there's a breach and then there is a subsequent waiver or there's a subsequent grace period, then how will you identify this as current versus non-current liabilities is particularly important. Generally, if the waiver happens during even the post-balance sheet period, it is treated as adjusting and you can still consider the liability to be a non-current liability. Okay, next, there's nothing much in index 1 as such. Apart from that, not very important. Then you go to index 34 in the sequence of the institute. This is on interim financial reporting. Over here, what is an interim period? An interim period is a period which is shorter than a financial year. It can be 12 months more or less, but it has to be shorter than a financial year. Secondly, in terms of presentation, you have the condensed financial statements and the complete financial statements. When you look at condensed financial statements, you will just give the headings and subheadings. So you will not give the details, disclosures, notes, schedules, etc. Just the heading and subheading. In complete financial statements, it is going to be a replica of your annual report presentation format. Then we go to the measurement and presentation, which is an important part. In terms of measurement, we generally follow the accrual, that is a discrete concept where we treat every quarter or every interim period as a separate financial period. And if an income or expense is accruing in that period, you will record it. The only exception to this is actually income tax, where we usually follow what we call as the integral view. That is, we look at the entire year. We estimate the income of the entire year, the estimated tax of the entire year, and you calculate the weighted average tax rate based on which you do find the income tax expense, which is the important part. When you look at interim statements, it is mandatory to prepare interim statements in consolidated books. If you have decided to follow interim statements, in the standalone books, it is optional. The type of questions that can come over here is on income tax, various varieties that you have on the weighted average tax rates workings, or questions where you would be given a profit and you would be required to adjust it to find the appropriate, the accurate profit during the period. Okay, so that takes care of Ind AS 34. Then you look at Ind AS 7. This is on cash flow statement. Well, there are three types of cash flows. There is cash flow from operating, where day-to-day business items are recorded. Investing, which includes buying, selling of assets, businesses, subsidiaries, fixed assets, intangible assets, and their corresponding incomes, like interest income, dividend income, etc., will also come over here. And then cash flow from financing, where sources of finance which you are raising as well as which you are redeeming will be covered in this section. There are two types of cash flows that you can prepare, the direct method and the indirect method. Indirect starts usually at the net profit, makes three adjustments in the cash flow from operations. One is non-cash, like depreciation. Second is non-operating, like loss on sale of fixed assets or interest expense or income. And third is the non-operating assets or liabilities adjustment, or loosely called as working capital adjustments, where if there's an increase in current assets, it's an opposite relation, you subtract. If it's an increase in current liabilities, it's a direct relation, you add. And that will give you cash flow from operations. Investing and financing remains the same irrespective of the method followed. There may be special items in this cash flow which would involve consolidation, which may sometimes have acquisition of businesses, some foreign currency transactions, which you need to be a little careful over here. So there would be cash and cash equivalents. At the end, you'll have opening cash and cash equivalents, closing cash and cash equivalents, and the net change between cash and cash equivalents. Cash equivalent is usually a component which is realizable in a very short term of time, that is less than 3 months from the date of acquisition, and which has a fairly liquid market and is realizable into a determinable amount of cash. Then you have this big standard of Ind AS 115, revenue recognition. The core principle behind this standard is you want to recognize the revenue as and when the performance obligations are discharged at an amount which the entity expects to receive, for which the revenue recognition standard has given you a 5-step model. Step number one, identify the contract. Usually contract is something which involves a commitment by both the parties to the contract. The price, the terms, the payment, the obligations are all clearly determined at this stage. If step one is fulfilled, then you go to step two, which is on performance obligations. These are basically promises that an entity expects on account of that revenue contract. Performance obligations, which are distinct, are to be recorded separately. Distinct obligations give you a certain benefit on account of that obligation, and at the same time, they are separately identifiable. When do you treat it to be separately identifiable? Well, if they are not a part of a significant integration exercise, they do not result in a significant modification or customization, and lastly, if they are not highly interrelated. If they are distinct, then the revenue recognition principles will be applied on each of these distinct performance obligations separately. Step number three involves transaction price, which is the consideration that you expect to receive, which would obviously include the fixed transaction price, will not include items like GST, for example. However, what about variable consideration? Well, it will be included if it is not constrained. So the entity does not expect it to be reversed if recorded right now. There are two ways of measuring variable consideration. There is the expected value method, which is the probability-based weighted average, and the most likely value method, in which case the most likely value is going to be considered. Either of these can work. Within this, the calculation for a significant financing component is important, where if the time gap between the date when the obligation is discharged and the consideration is received is more than 12 months, then you'll have to make an adjustment for time at the interest rate on a separate financing transaction. If not available, then at the IRR. Fourth step is allocation of transaction price. So if once you've determined the transaction price, you've determined the performance obligations, you will allocate it to each of these performance obligations based on what you call as the standalone selling price. The standalone selling price is usually the observable selling price of that performance obligation. If that is not available, the observable price, then you will try to value it. And the valuation over here can happen using various methods like the market approach or the comparable approach or the more common in an exam situation, the residual approach, which is usually a balancing figure. After that, you go to step 5, which is a revenue recognition step. Within this step, you will have to recognize revenue. Well, revenue is recognized when control is transferred, which can be transferred. Control for each performance obligation is transferred, which can be transferred either over time or at a point of time. When is it transferred over time? Well, if one of those three items happens, that is, if there is a simultaneous transfer of benefits, simultaneous transfer of benefits. Second, you are working on the customer's asset only. And third and the last, if you are entitled to a pro rata share of the compensation, including reasonable profit margin, and the contract is something which is exclusively for the customer. It cannot be used for some other customer. In which case, if one of the three is satisfied, the revenue will be recognized over time. If all the three are not satisfied, then the revenue is recognized at a point of time. If the revenue is recognized over time, then the revenue recognition happens based on the stage of completion method, which can be based on inputs, that is cost incurred divided by total estimated cost, or output, that is based on the fair value. In case it is point of time, it will be recorded usually when the risk and reward is transferred, the ownership of the items get transferred. There are a few other points like service concessions, intellectual properties, etc., which also require some specific guidance over here. Okay, perfect. Contract cost can be contract acquisition or contract fulfillment cost. They will be recognized in the P&L usually. However, if it is for contract which is more than 12 months, then contract acquisition cost can be recorded separately and can be amortized. Contract fulfillment cost can be recorded if it is not covered by any other accounting standard. So that takes care of revenue to the best effort basis. I'm sorry if you find it a little fast, but we have to kind of round it up in a limited time. Okay, so you have Ind AS 8, which is accounting policies. Three items over here, accounting policies, something like FIFO or weighted average, which if you change, you can change voluntarily if you think it is resulting in a better presentation, or it can change due to the application of Ind AS or a change in Ind AS. This will require a retrospective application, which means had this policy been applied all throughout, then what would be the accounting? That is what you will take, a retrospective application. Then is accounting estimates, like a useful life in case of an asset, that will require judgment in estimation and not really a method of accounting. And as a result, if there's any change, judgments are bound to change. This will be accounted for prospectively. The third and the last part is error. Error is mathematical, clerical. It is linked to facts. It is not linked to judgment. And error is a factual thing. Recording sales twice or forgetting to recognize sales, forgetting to recognize depreciation are all errors. Errors require a retrospective restatement. That is, you will restate the error in the previous year or the period prior to the previous year, that is in the opening balances, as if the error was actually rectified in that respective year. So a retrospective restatement or application happens if the error or the change in accounting policy pertains to the immediately preceding year, then line by line in the immediately preceding period. If it pertains to a period prior to the immediately preceding year, then the opening balances of the respective items like inventory and retained earnings, fixed assets and retained earnings, depending on the error items, will be adjusted. So that is about error. The retrospective restatement is required in all cases unless it is proven to be impracticable. Impracticable means even after applying all the efforts, you are still unable to quantify the impact. Maybe that is because of loss of data. Maybe it was destroyed due to a virus or a server attack, etc. So this is Ind AS 8. Then is Ind AS 10, which is events occurring after the balance sheet date. Two things you have to remember. First is, what is the post-balance sheet period? It is a period that starts after the balance sheet date immediately and ends when the directors sign or approve the accounts. It does not go on till the time the accounts are approved by the share or table to the shareholder, submitted to the regulator, does not matter. The date when the director signed, the final signing, is considered to be the date when the post-balance sheet period ends. Now, events that are happening during this period can be segregated into two parts, adjusting, non-adjusting. Adjusting events are those events which provide additional information of a condition existing on the acquisition date. For example, there was a debtor whose debt was bad. We were not aware of this because we did not go for collection. We went for collection in the post-balance sheet period and we found the debtor to be insolvent. Adjusting event. Non-adjusting event are, on the other hand, those events which are new events that arise after the balance sheet date but are material. For example, a dividend is declared in the post-balance sheet period or an amalgamation is announced in the post-balance sheet period are non-adjusting events. Non-adjusting events have to be disclosed in the notes. If material, adjusting events have to be adjusted in the accounts. Whether it is material or not, they have to be adjusted. Okay, then you have the standard on fair value measurement. Fair value is basically the exit price. That is the price that you will get if you were to sell an asset or the price that you will have to pay if you were to discharge a liability between market participants. It is not the entity's assessment. It is what a market participant will be willing to pay between market participants in the appropriate market. The appropriate markets over here can be either the principal market or the most advantageous market at the measurement date. What is the appropriate market? Well, two types of markets. The principal market is a market where there is a maximum volume of the transaction, buying and selling of the transaction that happens, maximum volume over and above any other market. Is it necessary that every product has a principal market? No. There might be certain products which do not have a principal market, like shares are listed on BSE and NSE and 20 other exchanges. You don't have a principal market, in which case you will go to the most advantageous market. That is a market which gives you the maximum in hand value. That is the price in the market determined using level 1, level 2, level 3 category inputs minus the transportation cost less the transaction cost. That will give you the net proceeds. The market which gives you the maximum net proceeds is considered to be the most advantageous market, and the fair value over there is the price determined using a valuation technique or level 1, level 2, level 3 category inputs. It is the price minus the transportation cost. That is the cost that is incurred to get the product to that market. Will we subtract transaction cost over here? No, you will not. If a transaction cost is also subtracted, it becomes fair value less cost to sell, or NRV, loosely speaking. In which case, this is how you determine fair values. Now, if it is a non-financial item which has multiple uses, then you select the highest and the best use. You don't need to exhaust each and every use. However, you need to ensure that the normal uses that will be considered by market participants in a particular geography are in fact covered. And the highest and the best use, after considering the expenses that you have to incur to get the asset ready for the alternative use, should be taken as the fair value over here. Then there is the fair value hierarchy. The golden rule of determining the price or determining the value is you will take the value based which, or the valuation method which maximizes the use of observable inputs and minimizes the use of unobservable inputs. What do you mean by observable, unobservable? Observable inputs are those inputs which are level 1 category, which is directly, it is prices of identical products in an active market. So this is level 1 category. If you have a 24 karat gold and you go to the market, something like MCX, and you see the price of 24 karat gold, that is a level 1 category inputs. Level 2 category would be an adjusted price. So let us say the market price is given for a 24 karat gold and a 22 karat gold, let us say roughly, but you have a 23 karat gold, you don't have a market, but you can take the average and find the adjusted price. And level 3 is unobservable, something like Gordon's formula, where you will make financial forecast, where you will estimate the key, estimate the growth, estimate the future cash flows. That is level 3. Given a choice, you will try to take that valuation technique which maximizes the use of level 1 category inputs and minimizes the use of level 3 category inputs. Okay, there are various valuation methods like market based, cash flow based, asset based, which are to be used in case price of level 1 category input is not available. If price is clearly determined from the market, you will directly take that, no valuation method required. Okay, then you go to Ind AS 20, which is accounting for government grants. Government grants can be of two types, and before that there's a difference between grants and assistance. Grant can be quantified, assistance cannot be quantified. Grants will be accounted, assistance will be merely disclosed. So when you look at grants, when do you account for the grants? Well, when you believe that the conditions linked to the grant will be fulfilled. You don't have to wait till actual fulfillment, and the grant will be receivable. That means you don't have to wait till the time you actually receive. It is accrual basis. Secondly, once you decide that this is a grant, can be quantified, then you will segregate into two parts. There is an asset link grant which is directly attributable to acquisition, construction or procurement of a specific item like PP or intangible asset, or revenue grant, which was called in AS12, which is now called as a grant linked to income, which is a negative definition, which means everything which is not an asset linked grant will become a grant linked to income. What is the accounting for an asset linked grant? Well, you have two choices. You can either credit the grant to a deferred grant account and then amortize it in the ratio of depreciation if available, and if no depreciation like land, then in an appropriate ratio. Or you can reduce it directly from the cost of the PP, and the net cost will then be depreciated, no separate amortization required. If you look at a grant linked to income, this grant will be dependent on whether this is a grant which is given for fulfillment of some future expenses like training expenses or research expenses, or it is a compensation for some past losses or expenses that have already happened. So if it is a compensation for past losses, expenses, or it is unconditional, no condition given, then you'll record it in the P&L immediately. However, if it is linked to some future expenses, some future incomes, in which case you'll record it in the deferred grant account and then amortize the deferred grant to the P&L over the period over which those expenses are expected to be incurred. This income linked grant, the amortization can be shown in the P&L either in other income or it can be reduced from the cost. Either ways, but in case of an asset linked grant, depreciation has to be shown separately, as well as if there is any amortization of grant, if you take the deferred grant method, has to be shown separately. Okay, so that kind of takes care of grant. So Ind AS 102 is also actually treated as a separate chapter, but we'll do a quick roundup over here. Ind AS 102 has two types. It is equity settled plan. These are share based payments that can be settled in shares or it can be based on shares. So when you look at settlement in shares, it is like an ESOP settlement based on shares. It's like a stock appreciation right or a share appreciation right. You can have this transaction with the employees or parties who are other than employees as well. If you have it with employees, like ESOP, for example, you in that case, you will take the fair value as on the grant date, no revaluation, no remeasurement, and you will amortize it on a straight line basis over the vesting period. If it is a cash settled plan like a SAR, you will take the fair value at each balance sheet date because it is in the nature of liability and still amortize it over the entire vesting period. If it is other than employees, that is like goods and services, then you will recognize it based on the fair value of the goods or services as the case may be, and if that is not determinable, that is when you will go to the fair value of the shares, recognizing it when the goods and services are actually received or the services are actually rendered as the case may be. There would be some special cases like market linked and non-market linked performance conditions. If there are performance conditions which are non-market linked, then at each balance sheet date you will have to reassess the vesting period. You will have to reassess the possibility of the of non-vesting at each balance sheet date. But in case of market linked performance conditions, do not do that. Rationale being, the fair value is determined based on the market price, and if the fair value cannot change, the estimates behind that also cannot change. Some special cases like modification, in case there's a modification in the exercise price, in which case you treat it as a new plan, find the incremental fair value if positive and spread it over the remaining vesting period. In case it is a cancellation, then you treat it as acceleration of vesting. You consider as if the plan is vested, record the entire expenses, and then adjust the SBP reserve against the fair value of the cash settlement. Okay, so this is on share-based payment. Then you have first-time adoption. First-time adoption, ke andar aapko pata hona chahiye, what is the transition date? Transition date is the date when your first, if your first financial year, when you're applying Ind AS, is the year 2021, jo aap likhoge exams mein, is the year 2021. In the year 2021, that is the first financial statements. You'll have to show the prior period, that is the year 1920. And the first day of that year, that is 1st of April 2019, will be the date when you will transition to Ind AS. You will compare that with the accounting under, in India, AS, that is called as previous gap. And you will make certain adjustments. Usual rules are, you when you transition, let us say from 31st March 19 to 1st of April 19, you will have to remeasure all assets and liabilities as per Ind AS, unless some deemed cost exemption is given under Ind AS 101. You will have to reclassify items under Ind AS. Like for example, investment property has to be reclassified. Preference share capital will probably go into liabilities. You will have to de-recognize items which have been recorded, like इन द ओल्डर स्टैंडर्ड मे बी प्रपोज डिविडेंड वॉज रिकॉर्डेड. अभी अपन बोलते हैं वी विल रिकॉर्ड डिविडेंड ओनली नॉट वेन बोर्ड प्रपोजेज इट बट वेन द शेयर होल्डर्स अप्रूव ऑफ इट इन विच केस एनी प्रपोज डिविडेंड वी विल हैव टू डी रिकॉग्नाइज और रिकॉग्नाइज आइटम्स विच हैव नॉट येट बीन रिकॉग्नाइज अंडर अंडर एस. सो दीज आर योर स्टैंडर्ड वर्किंग्स अनलेस a mandatory exception or an optional exemptions are given where there is a list of a lot of exceptions or exemptions like ESOP, foreign currency, PP which is very important where you can take the previous gap carrying value or the fair value as the case may be as the deemed cost. You look at amalgamation or business combination in which case you can assume that the business combination either will be retrospectively restated as per index or there will be no restatement. Non-controlling interest will be based on the principles of the business combination. FCTR, if any, can be reset to nil or a retrospective restatement. In case of ESOPs which have vested, you can either follow the previous gap workings or you can follow the fair value. For unvested options, you don't have that choice. And so on. There are various items over here. Financial instruments, there are various items over here. So this is on Ind AS 101. Then you go to the, so this takes care of your entire module 1. Now you go to module number 2, which is the asset linked standards part. Okay, so we'll go to the asset linked part, which is starting with inventory, that is Ind AS 2. Inventory, you have three inventories are items which you are holding for sale in the ordinary course of business, which includes finished goods and stock in trade, also includes raw materials, work in progress, stores and spares, if they don't meet the PPE criteria, for example. Now, inventory has three main segregations. One is the cost. One is determination of cost. One is the cost flow assumptions like FIFO weighted average. And lastly, is the inventory valuation. When you're looking at cost, you will take the purchase price, add non-creditable or non-refundable taxes, subtract discounts like trade discounts, and add directly attributable expenses which are incurred to bring the inventory in the location and condition as desired by the management. While you are doing this, you have to be very careful in the overheads absorption, which is usually based on the normal levels, unless if your actuals are greater, then you will take whichever is higher, normal or actual, whichever is higher, but otherwise it is usually under the normal levels. Borrowing costs can be capitalized in certain cases in inventory if the inventory is taking a substantial period of time to be ready for its intended use, subjected to certain exceptions. Then if there is a normal loss, remember, is a part of the cost. Abnormal loss goes to the profit and loss account. If there is a joint product and a byproduct, you will allocate the net joint cost after deducting the NRV of the byproduct in the ratio of the sales value at the split off point. Once you are able to determine cost, you will go to the measurement of cost in each balance sheet date, because inventory is bought and sold very frequently, and hence you have to follow specific identification method only if the inventory items are not interchangeable, like museum artifacts, like precious paintings, etc. Otherwise, you can follow the general methods, which is FIFO and weighted average. LIFO is not permitted. For certain businesses which have a long manufacturing history and a clear cost structure, they can also follow the standard cost technique. And in case of retailers, they are optionally allowed to even follow the retail sales price method, that is the MRP or the sales price minus the gross margin. For simplicity, valuation of inventory, that is in the nature of finished goods and WIP, happens at cost or NRV, whichever is lower. Whereas when you look at raw materials, it is usually measured at cost only because the intention is to use it. However, in case the NRV of the finished goods is lower than the cost, which means the finished goods may not really be manufactured, in that case, you can measure the raw materials at the lower of cost or the replacement cost, that is the cost that will be incurred to buy the raw materials right now, whichever is lower. It is taken as a proxy for NRV, the replacement cost workings. Okay, so that largely takes care of inventory. Then is Ind AS 16, PP. Again, PP are those items which are tangible, which are held for use, and which have a life of more than 12 months in general, in which case how will we recognize the initial cost of PP? Exactly the same way as inventory, that is purchase price plus non-refundable, non-creditable taxes, less discounts if any, plus directly attributable expense. However, you will also add a provision for site restoration or dismantling if any, which is calculated on a present value terms in the cost of PP. After you have recognized the initial cost of PP, subsequent expenditure, ideally, if the subsequent expenditure increases the life or efficiency, then you add it. If it is regular day to day, it will go to the profit and loss. However, if there's a major replacement, a major overhaul or a major inspection, you will add the cost of the new part or the new inspection or the new overhaul, and at the same time subtract the WDV of the old part. How do you find that WDV? Well, we will take the initial cost, and from the initial cost, if I have a breakup in the invoice, excellent. If no, then I will assume notionally that the cost of the current part is same to be the cost of the old part, but the old part was purchased earlier, and hence you might have to do a time value adjustment. And after that, today, while removing, you will have to do a depreciation adjustment. These two adjustments will be done. If there is a subsequent valuation now in the balance sheet, if you have to subsequently value something in the balance sheet, at each balance sheet date, you can either compare, calculate using the cost model or a revaluation model. This is an accounting policy choice. Cost model will take the initial cost. No revaluation is permitted. From that, you'll subtract the accumulated depreciation and the accumulated impairment. No special guidance over here. But the revaluation model, you'll have to determine fair value. When? Well, at sufficient intervals. How is that defined? It is 12 months in case of assets with volatile values, whereas if it is stable values, then it is anywhere between 3 to 5 years. Like furniture has stable values, but gold ornaments might have volatile values. If you revalue one, do you have to revalue everything? No. Revaluation has to be done uniformly for a class of PP. That is, PP having similar nature and end use have to be revalued consistently. But merely because you're revaluing one class of PP does not mean you have to revalue every other class of PP. You have to take that choice class of PP wise. If there is a revaluation and it is an upward revaluation, it goes into something called as a revaluation reserve, which is a part of your other comprehensive income, which is not reclassifiable, which means if there is a sale of the PP, the balance in the revaluation reserve will be transferred to the retained earnings directly. It will not go to the statement of profit and loss account. If there's a downward revaluation, on the other hand, it will directly go to the profit and loss account. And accordingly, if there's a subsequent upward after an initial downward, or if there's a subsequent downward after an initial upward, you will ensure that you first adjust from the balances where they had earlier gone, and then take it to the P&L or the revaluation reserve respectively. Then you go to depreciation. Depreciation is based on the useful life, based on the salvage value. These estimates have to be reassessed at each balance sheet date. However, the important thing for you to remember is a change from SLM to WDV or vice versa is not a change in accounting policy. You might have studied that in inter, but at final, it is not. And when it is a change in accounting policy, Ind AS 16 clearly tells you it's a change in accounting estimate. There is a component method of depreciation which says that if an asset like an aircraft or a land and building has various major components, and unless given otherwise, a component is assumed to be major, which have lives which are different, which have useful lives which are different, in which case you will have to segregate that asset into its components. Like a furnished flat, for example, between the furniture and the flat, you'll have to segregate it between its components and then recognize depreciation based on the useful life of that component and not a uniform base for recognition of depreciation. So component method, if an asset has components, it is mandatory. Okay. Then you look at Ind AS 116. This is on leases. The first part of the standard tells you that where will this apply? Well, if an arrangement is, or whether it contains a lease, when does it contain a lease? Well, if it has an identified asset, that is, most of the cases physically distinct, and we are getting the right to direct use. When do you get the right to direct use? For a specified period, when you get substantially all the benefits which are linked to the asset, and you get the right to control the use or direct the use, which can be if you have the right to operate the asset yourself, or you can appoint people to operate the asset, or the design of the asset is such that and you have designed that the use can be directed by you, and substantially all benefits, direct or indirect, are going to be taken by the entity. Second, once you figure out that an arrangement is or contains a lease, then you have to segregate between lease and non-lease components. There may be certain lease and certain non-lease components. For example, when you take a car with a driver, the driver is the non-lease component, whereas the car is the lease component. You will have to allocate consideration to the lease component and the non-lease component separately. Ind AS 116 applies only to the lease component. Non-lease component, respective accounting standard will apply. It is very much possible that there are multiple lease components. If there are multiple lease components, you will have to allocate between all the individual lease components in the ratio of the standalone selling price. The standard also gives you a practical expedient, or also called as a shortcut, whereby if you want, you may not segregate the lease and the non-lease component separately. However, no such exception has been given for lease components. You will have to segregate all the lease components separately. Okay, next you go to the important terms, which is inception and commencement of lease. Inception is the lease when generally the conditions which are linked to lease have been finalized substantially or the lease agreement has been signed. Commencement of the lease is the date when you get the physical possession of the asset. Accounting starts from the commencement date. Identification of lease is happening on the initial date. Important terms are lease term. Lease term will obviously include the non-cancellable period and the renewal period. Or the period covered under the termination clause can be included if you are reasonably certain that the renewal is going to happen or the termination is not going to happen. That is when you will include it in the lease term calculation. Then is lease payments. Lease payments will obviously include the fixed payments. Variable payments can be included only if they are linked to a rate or an index. Otherwise, they are not going to be included. Then you have, let us say, payment under a termination option or a purchase option if there is any, and a residual value guarantee. These will be included in the lease payment, and what goes into the lease payment goes into the lease liability determination. Then you have interest rate, the discount rate. Discount rate is treated as a first preference as the interest rate implicit in the lease, that is the IRR, and if that is not available, then the interest in a separate transaction if you were to go and borrow. And if there are any initial direct costs which are directly linked to the lease, they are called as initial direct costs. Then goes the accounting. Accounting in case of certain, subject to certain exceptions, recognition exceptions, like a short-term lease which has a lease term of less than 12 months, or a lease of a low value item which has not been defined specifically, but it is case to case. In these two cases, the entity has an option of following the accounting as rent account debit to bank and P&L account debit to rent. Do not recognize the ROU asset or lease liability as an optional treatment. However, in all other cases, you have to recognize a lease liability which is present value of future lease payments. These lease payments are as defined, include variable lease payments which are linked to rate or index, fixed lease payments, etc., discounted at the interest rate implicit in the lease for the entire lease term. And whatever is the lease liability is usually the ROU asset. However, there can be certain items which are there in the ROU asset, which can be provision of site restoration, initial direct cost, or transactions that have happened before the commencement date, which may also be a part of ROU asset, not a part of lease liability. Achha. Then the depreciation will be recorded over the lease term or over the useful life, depending on how long the asset is going to stay with the entity. Lease liability accounting is very similar to the amortized cost table that you prepare under Ind AS 109, very, very similar to that. Can the lease liability and ROU asset subsequently change? Yes, if there's a modification in the lease term, it can change. The modification can be in terms of changes in lease rent, changes in the lease tenure, or changes in the asset for which you are getting the right to use. More or less area can be received. This is a lease modification. Can either be accounted by an adjustment of lease liability with the ROU asset, or it can also go to the profit and loss. Various scenarios are there. There can also be some remeasurement where you are not going and modifying physically the lease terms. However, you are indeed changing the estimates. Like, for example, the possibility the renewal option can be exercised, the possibility that the purchase option will be exercised, etc., are all remeasurements. I have to look at the detailed guidance over there. There's also a COVID-19 linked practical expedient which has been given, which mentions that if there is a change in the lease, which is let us say reduction in lease, loosely speaking, up to periods of 30th of June 2021 maximum, and there's no other changes, then this can be taken directly as a negative variable lease payment and it can be taken to the P&L instead of adjusting the ROU asset and stuff. So that is an optional simplification given. Accounting in the books of lessor is depending on finance lease and operating lease. Finance lease is the lease where the lessor transfers substantially the risks and rewards to the lessee. In operating lease, he does not. Then you have sublease cases where in the books of that intermediate party, who is the intermediate lessor, will also have a right of use because he is the lessee, and he will also give out an operating or finance lease. So you have to be careful. Then you have sale and leaseback transactions where you have to see whether the sale and leaseback, the selling price is greater than fair value or the selling price is less than fair value. In cases where the selling price is greater than fair value, there is an implicit. In one of the cases, if the selling price, that is what you are as an intermediate lessor, there can be in one case a hidden financing component, in the other case there can be a hidden right of use asset or a prepaid lease payment. And then there is transition, which is not as important, where you can when you are transitioning from the older standards to the new standard. Certain optional exemptions have been given. So we spent a lot of time on lease, but it is one big standard. Chalo. After that, you go to borrowing cost. Borrowing cost usually goes to the profit and loss account. However, if the borrowing cost is incurred for a qualifying asset, that is an asset that necessarily or normally takes a substantial period of time to be ready for its intended use, then the borrowing cost can be capitalized. From when can you start capitalization? Well, from the date, which is the later of the date when the loan is taken, or the date when the activities commence, or the date when expenditure is incurred, you will continue capitalization till substantially all activities which are necessary to get the asset in the ready to use condition are completed. In the middle, if there is an interruption for an extended period of time, which is due to abnormal factors beyond the entity's control and which are not necessary to get the asset in the ready to use condition, then for that period, like a lockdown, for example, there can be a suspension of capitalization. What are borrowing costs? Well, borrowing costs can include interest, which is calculated using the effective interest method, can include finance charges under a finance lease, under a ROU asset and lease liability, and can also include exchange differences, that is forex gain or loss, to the extent they are considered as adjustment to the interest cost, which is calculated by various steps. You will compare the exchange loss with the interest adjustment, the saving in interest by borrowing in the foreign currency, and select whichever is lower, that is also going to be considered. There are two types of borrowings. There's a general borrowing and specific borrowing. Specific borrowing, remember, the borrowing cost capitalization starts entirely from the commencement date, irrespective of whether full expenditure is incurred or not. If the expenditure starts, capitalization starts from the commencement date, and if there is any income on temporary investment of surplus funds, you will subtract it. On the general borrowing, on the other hand, the capitalization is linked to the expenditure that is incurred. So as and when the expenditure is incurred, you will recognize the borrowing cost and accordingly you will solve. Over here, you will calculate the weighted average borrowing rate, where you will take the borrowing cost of general borrowings, which is not directly attributable to acquisition of a particular specific asset, divided by the weighted average borrowing cost. Whatever is the weighted average borrowing rate, you will multiply it with the expenditure incurred out of general borrowings, that is after deducting the expenditure from the specific borrowings, and whatever is the eligible borrowing cost, you would ideally capitalize, subject to the fact that you check that it does not exceed the actual borrowing cost. So I guess that kind of does a fair roundup on Ind AS 23. Then you go to Ind AS 36, which is impairment, over which there are two main sections to study. One is a single asset impairment and one is a CGU, cash generating unit impairment. First, for single assets, when is there an impairment? If you compare the carrying value, that is the ledger balance, the WDV, with the recoverable value, which is the higher of the net selling price, that is fair value less the cost to sell, or the value in use, which is usually the present value of future cash flows. Higher of the two is the recoverable value, and there is an impairment when the carrying value is greater, that is you are unable to recover what the benefits of the assets are. Aapne ledger mein 10 lakh dikha hai, the best case you take and you're still able to recover, let us say 8 lakhs, then 2 lakhs is the impairment, which will go to the profit and loss account. Unless the asset has been earlier revalued and there's a revaluation reserve which is existing, then you will first adjust it against the revaluation reserve, and then it will go to the profit and loss account. Next, you go to impairment. Usually, indicators of impairment. Impairment does not happen each year. It happens when indicators like a big lockdown or a demand reduction or a new technology, legal change, etc. happens. However, if there are three items where there is annual impairment required, which is intangibles with an indefinite life, intangibles under development, and goodwill under business combination require an annual impairment review. When you are trying to look at the reversal of impairment, you have to be careful that you can reverse impairment not blindly. You can't, if there's an indicator of reversal, first of all, goodwill impairment cannot be reversed. But other than goodwill, if there's an indicator of reversal of impairment, then you will find the recoverable value and you will reverse it, provided there's an improvement in service potential, that is a cash flow generating capability of the asset or the net selling price, as the case may be, in which case you can reverse. But while reversing, you have to remember that you can't take it above the value, that is the recoverable value or the carrying value, had there been no impairment. Then you go to the cash generating unit, which is the smallest group of identifiable assets that is capable of generating a largely independent cash flow, that is called as a cash generating unit. When do you go to cash generating unit? When you are unable to determine the independent cash flows on a single asset basis, in which case you go to the next best, that is a cash generating unit. Impairment testing for a cash generating unit, you will first determine the carrying value of the cash generating unit, which includes the carrying value of the individual assets inside the cash generating unit as identified by the management, can include even items like inventory. plus the allocable goodwill plus the allocable corporate assets. Second, you compare the recoverable value of the entire CGU and find the impairment. And whatever is that impairment loss will first be absorbed by the goodwill. And excess, if any, will be absorbed by all other eligible assets. Items like inventory will not absorb any loss, not covered by Ind AS 36, will absorb all the losses in the ratio of their carrying value. However, while doing so, you have to particularly ensure that the value after recognizing the impairment loss cannot fall below the individual net selling price or value in use for an individual asset to whom the loss is allocated, as the case may be. The principles of reversal will apply similarly over here. In case there is a subsidiary to whom impairment is to be done, you will have to take the method of looking at whether it is a full goodwill or a partial goodwill method. If it is full goodwill, quotation A, you will find the goodwill, take the impairment loss. This impairment loss for goodwill as well as for other assets will be borne by parent and NCI both. However, if it is partial goodwill method, you will first have to gross up the goodwill. Why? Because the recoverable value is for the entire CGU, whereas assets and liabilities are fully taken, but goodwill is partial, and hence you'll have to gross up the goodwill, find the impairment loss, allocate that loss between goodwill and other assets. The part of the loss which is attributable to NCI on goodwill will not be absorbed by the NCI because goodwill is not recorded. However, for other assets, the loss will be borne by parent and NCI both. We have put a separate video as well for this. You can refer that. Then you go to Ind AS 38, which is on intangible assets, which have to be identifiable, which means they are either separable or they arise from a contractual or a legal right, like a license. They have to be non-monetary and they lack physical substance. You can recognize an intangible if future benefits are expected and cost is determinable. And hence, a lot of internally generated assets where cost is not measurable reliably cannot be recorded. The other principles of Ind AS 38 largely are very similar, like cost, subsequent expenditure, subsequent balance sheet are very similar to PPE. However, there's a specific case for research and development. Research expenses is the ideation phase where you're just trying to find the outcome, not yet found. All the expenses in the research phase will be taken to the P&L account. However, when we go to the development phase, these expenses will be capitalized subjected to certain conditions. Then you look at amortization. Usually, if intangible assets have a finite life, you will amortize it over the finite life. And if the life is not determinable, then you will test it for impairment annually. There is no 10-year limit for amortization. Other principles are same as Ind AS 16. Just remember that revaluation model can be taken only if the fair value can be determined by an active market, otherwise no. Then you look at investment property. Investment property is land, building or both, which is either acquired by the entity, owned by the entity or held as a right of use asset, and which is held primarily with the objective of earning rental income, capital appreciation or both, and not held for own use, not held for the purpose of sale. Investment property accounting, if it is dual use, you have to ensure that if the dual components can be segregated like two separate floors, then you will record it proportionately, proportionate PP, proportionate investment property. However, if they cannot be segregated, they will be taken as PP unless the own use component is insignificant. The accounting will be exactly similar as PP, just that you will have to follow the cost model. Revaluation model in India has been prohibited. You just cannot follow it. However, the fair value has to be disclosed. Remember, the building component of investment property will still be depreciated. Okay, so that is investment property. Non-current assets held for sale. There are three key terms over here. First is non-current asset, that is other than current. Then there is disposal group, which is a group of non-current assets, like a classroom, multiple assets which are there inside a classroom, which is held for sale, or a discontinued operation where there is an entire segment of business that you are planning to sell or dispose of, as the case may be. The accounting over here, or the classification as a non-current asset held for sale, will happen provided the asset is available for immediate sale in the present condition. So no renovation is pending. There's no backlog which is pending for which you want to finish. And the sale is highly probable. That is when the appropriate level of management is committed. When an active sale process has been started, when the price at which you're marketing is reasonable and the sale process is expected to get done in 12 months and there's no likelihood of you going back from the sale plan. If that is the case, then the accounting will be, and the date of reclassification after applying all indices, the carrying value will be compared with the fair value less cost to sell, not the recoverable value, fair value less cost to sell. And if there's a reduction, that will be taken as impairment, and that impairment will go to the profit and loss account under Ind AS 105. In case there is a disposal group, the principles of cash generating unit largely apply to be the same. In case there is a discontinued operation, in which case again it is like a disposal group, so your write-off of assets and liabilities is going to happen like a disposal group, just that the profit or loss from a discontinued operation has to be recorded separately in the income statement. You need to remember that. Next, we have Ind AS 41, which is on agriculture. This covers biological assets other than bearer plants, covers agricultural produce up to the or at the point of harvest, and government grants linked to biological assets. Biological assets at initial recognition, subsequent recognition will all be measured at fair value less cost to sell. And if there's any gain or loss, that will go to the profit and loss account. Agricultural produce at the point of harvest will be measured at fair value less cost to sell, and that will become the initial cost for inventory. And if you look at a government grant which is linked to a biological asset, then you will not apply Ind AS 20. Instead, you will record it if it is conditional, for example, for a cow, or unconditional. If it is unconditional, you take it to the P&L immediately. No amortization in the ratio of depreciation life of the cow, no. If it is conditional, you record it as and when the conditions are fulfilled. So this is about agriculture, that takes care of your module 2, and then a certain section of module 3 which are there, which is what we are trying to cover. Employee benefits. Employee benefits have 4 categories of employee benefits. There are 4 categories of employee benefits. Short-term benefits, which is for a period of less than 12 months. It is to be accounted as and when the services are rendered. Second is the post-employment benefits. That is benefits that you are receiving at or after retirement, like gratuity, pension, provident fund, etc., which can be segregated between defined contribution, where the employer's commitment is linked to the contribution only, like a provident fund, which is with the government. Or a defined benefit, in which case the benefit is defined like gratuity, and hence the expense is irrespective of the contribution. In case of a defined contribution plan, the expense is the contribution amount. In case of defined benefit plan, you will have to measure the expense using actuarial valuation, applying the projected unit credit method, whereby you will find the current service cost, the past service cost if applicable, the interest cost, etc. There is also some actuarial gain or loss which can arise due to changes in actuarial assumptions, which will go in the remeasurement reserve, which is a part of other comprehensive income. There is a very detailed guidance which you will have to refer. You just can't refer summary videos or a 2-minute video for that. For the accounting for defined benefit plans, you will have to refer. Other long-term benefits and post-employment benefits, accounting is almost the same, except the 3 items that go in the remeasurement reserve as a part of OCI, that is the gain or loss on account of changes in actuarial assumptions, the gain or loss due to changes in return of plan sets, and the gain or loss due to the application of asset ceiling, which all go in the other comprehensive income under post-employment benefits, do actually go into the profit and loss in case of other long-term benefits. When we look at your overall balance sheet presentation, in the profit and loss, you'll have the current service cost, you'll have the past service cost, you'll have the net interest amount, and any gain or loss on curtailment. In the balance sheet, you'll have plan liabilities and plan assets. Plan liabilities, you'll have the opening liabilities, which will go up due to interest, which will go up due to current service costs. If there's any past service costs and a change in the remeasurement, will give you the closing liability. There will also be a plan asset which will have an opening balance, will increase due to the return, which is usually expected, will increase due to contribution, will reduce due to benefits paid. Even the liability will reduce due to benefits paid. And if there's any changes in return, that will also go to the OCI. In the balance sheet, you will have the presentation as a net presentation. So your liability minus asset will be presented subjected to asset ceiling. So if there's a surplus, that will be subject to the asset ceiling, and lower of the two will be presented. This is your overall roundup on the summary. And lastly, you have termination benefits. These are benefits which you pay at the time of termination. These are benefits which are paid at the time of termination when the employee is announced a VRS or a retrenchment, will be recorded if expenses are directly linked to the termination of an employee. That is Ind AS 19. Then is Ind AS 37. This is provisions and contingencies. First of all, what is a liability? Well, it is arising out of a present obligation. What is a contingency? A possible obligation. How do you account for a contingency? Can be contingent liability, can be contingent asset. If it is a contingent liability, it will be accounted. In the books, a provision will be made if it is probable, that is more likely than not, more than 50% chance. If it is uncertain, it will be disclosed, and if it is remote, then it will be ignored. Contingent asset, on the other hand, can be recorded, can be disclosed if it is probable, ignored if it is uncertain. If it is virtually certain, that is beyond all doubts and based on factual confirmation, then it can be accounted in the books. If there is a reimbursement asset or reimbursement agreed, then only the net of reimbursement expenses will be recorded. Provisions will be created on a present value basis if the effect of time is material, that is more than 12 months, and provisions can be measured using the expected value method or more likely value method, whatever is more suitable. If there is an adjustment for risk required and it is given like a buffer or a safety margin, then you will incorporate that into your workings as well, and the expected gains or losses on sale of assets have to be ignored. Beyond this, you have something called as onerous contract, which is a burdensome contract, which is where the unavoidable cost of fulfilling or completing the contract exceeds the benefits that you are going to receive out of the contract. And what do you need to do? You need to immediately recognize the unavoidable loss, which is the loss on completing the contract and the loss on cancelling the contract, whichever is lower. The unavoidable loss has to be recognized immediately. Then you had the restructuring. Restructuring is a potential closure, termination of a line of activity or business, in which case you will have to create a provision for restructuring. When do we have to create? Well, when the obligation to restructure arises. It can be a legal obligation due to a court order or constructive obligation, which may be due to a finalization of a detailed plan and then subsequently communicating that plan or starting to implement that plan. Only the directly attributable items like termination, like legal expenses will be a part of provision. Anything which is indirect will not be a part of provision. So, for example, relocation expenses or let us say setting up of new system related expenses will not be a part of the restructuring provision. If you are expecting losses in the subsequent year, which is not linked to an onerous contract, regular operating losses, you cannot create a provision. You will record it as and when they happen. Okay, so that is Ind AS 37. Then you go to Ind AS 12, which is on income taxes, covers current tax as well as deferred tax. Current tax is due to the application of current income tax laws that you have to pay. Deferred tax is due to temporary differences. Temporary differences between carrying value, that is the value as per Ind AS, and the tax base, which is the value as per the tax balance sheet. When we compare this with other than temporary differences, over here it is not that the differences are going to arise in one of the years and reverse, like depreciation is temporary. However, a contribution to an unrecognized trust is permanent. You will never ever get a deduction for income tax pertaining to that. So you will create deferred tax only on temporary differences, and these temporary differences can be of two types. It can be taxable temporary differences, which will result in more tax in the future years, which is called as a deferred tax liability, or a deductible temporary differences, which will create a deferred tax asset, which will result in deduction from taxes in the future years. There are various ways in which you think and apply this. We have discussed that, but if you were to go through a simple stepwise procedure from an exam perspective, step number one, calculate carrying value, apply Ind AS. Step number two, calculate tax base. Think of it as if you are preparing the tax balance sheet and find the value of the asset and liability in the tax balance sheet. Step number three, if the difference is temporary, then difference into the tax rate will be the deferred tax amount. Now, identification of whether it is an asset or a liability, you see whether the underlying item is an asset, like PPE for example is an asset and loan for example is a liability. If the underlying item is an asset, the thumb rule is, if the carrying value of the underlying item, whether asset or liability, is greater, then the answer is always opposite, which means that if the carrying value of PPE is greater as compared to the tax base, answer is deferred tax liability. If the carrying value of a liability like a loan is greater as compared to the tax base, answer is deferred tax asset. If the carrying value is lower, the answer is in the same direction, which means if the carrying value of PPE is lower as compared to the tax base, that will result in an asset ke samne deferred tax asset, and if there's a liability, then liability ke samne deferred tax liability. If the carrying value and tax base are equal, there is no deferred tax. The tax rate for current tax should be the tax applicable in the current year. For deferred tax, it is a tax which is applicable in future financial years, which has been enacted or substantially enacted till the balance sheet date. Then when we proceed, there are certain conditions for creating deferred tax asset. You should have sufficient benefits to utilize those that deduction or a carry forward loss, as the case may be, that involve taxable temporary differences that will reverse in the same period when the deductible temporary difference is reverse, or sufficient taxable profit, or the implementation of a tax planning strategy or a mechanism where you can legally utilize the profits. If that is the case, then you can create a deferred tax asset. Otherwise, creating deferred tax asset is not possible. Deferred tax liability is almost created in every situation, except in certain cases like goodwill. Certain exceptions have been given in case of subsidiaries and associates. If you can control the timing of reversal, that is, you can control the timing of dividend, like in subsidiary, in which case you are exempted from creating a deferred tax liability. So that is largely taking care of income taxes. Then you go to foreign exchange. Foreign exchange again has three main segregations or two main segregations. One is the foreign currency transactions and then is foreign currency translations. First of all, you need to know what is a functional currency. Functional currency is the currency of the primary economic environment in which the entity operates, which can be determined looking at the currency that the entity uses and which actually influences the sale price, the cost and the competitive environment. If these indicators don't give you a clear parameter, then you will look at the additional factors like sources of financing and sources of retention, as the case may be. That will help you in determining the functional currency. If the you will maintain your books of accounts in the functional currency. Foreign currency is defined as a currency other than the functional currency, and presentation currency is the currency which you use for the preparation of your financial statements. If the transaction is happening between the entity and the other party in a foreign currency, you will recognize the transaction initially at the exchange rate which is prevailing as on the date of transaction. If the exchange rates are stable, you can also take the average rate. At the time of preparing balance sheet, the assets and liabilities have to be restated. The monetary items have to be going at the closing rate, non-monetary at the historic rate. Monetary items are items whose values are in the balance sheet are reflecting the realizable values. Non-monetary do not reflect the realizable values. Gain or loss, if any, on translation, on remeasurement or on actual settlement will go to the P&L. If there is a foreign operation like a foreign subsidiary, then you have to translate the financials of the foreign subsidiary into the Indian currency, which happens at the closing rate. All assets and liabilities, whether monetary or non-monetary, will go at the closing rate. The incomes and expenses will usually be at the rate as on the date of transaction, but since there are so many transactions, for simplicity we can take the average rate. The balance, if any, due to the application of different exchange rates, will go to the foreign currency translation reserve, that is FCTR, which will remain as a part of OCI till the time there is a net disposal of the foreign operation. When you actually dispose of the foreign operation, that is when the balance will go to the profit and loss account. If there are any intercompany items at the stage of consolidation, you have to be careful about that. And you also have to look at if there is an investment which you are making, which is in the nature of net investment. So a loan given without any settlement terms is actually a part of the net investment of foreign operation. And hence, even though in the SFS, you can take it in the P&L, at the time of preparing CFS, any gain or loss over there has to be taken back to the foreign currency translation reserve, a fairly technical point. Goodwill, remember, will always be recorded at the exchange rate prevailing at the closing. So you'll find the goodwill in dollars and then convert it at the closing rate. Okay. So that kind of takes care of foreign exchange. When we look at related parties, in terms of related parties, the related party report is prepared in the notes to accounts, and in the notes to accounts you have to give details of who is the related parties, that is the name and the relationship, as well as the transactions and the outstanding balances have to be separately disclosed. Who all are related parties? Well, persons who are individuals who are in control, who have joint control or have significant influence are related parties, and apart from that, entities who are members of the same group, like parent subsidiary or fellow subsidiary relationship, who are associates or joint ventures of the entity, or who are co-joint ventures, or one joint venture and one associate can be taken, but two co-associates are not related parties. If there is an individual or his close family member who is having control or joint control in one of the parties, and is having control, joint control, significant influence, or even a key managerial personnel in the other party, then both of them are also considered to be related parties. Apart from that, the entity and its provident fund, or an entity with another entity who is providing key managerial services, are also related parties. And individually, for persons who are KMPs of the entity or KMPs of the parent entity, are treated as related parties. All the related party transactions that have happened when the related party relationship was in existence have to be disclosed. Additionally, when we are looking at preparing a related party report, you have to show the transactions as well as the outstanding balances in all cases, except there is an exception given for government where the related party relationship comes into existence only because two parties are related directly or indirectly to the government. Then you just have to give the name of the government and you are exempted from giving a detailed disclosure of these transactions. This is about related parties. Remember, you have to give this disclosure in the notes to accounts, irrespective, in standalone and consolidated both, irrespective of whether the transactions happen at arm's length or fair prices or not. Then you go to Ind AS 33, which is EPS. There are two types of EPS. There is a basic EPS and diluted EPS. Basic EPS, net profit attributable to shareholders divided by weighted average number of shares, where the weighted average shares are calculated taking the time as weights. If they are partly paid, you convert into equivalent fully paid. If shares are issued free, that is without consideration, then you will retrospectively restate them from the earliest reported date. If, let us say, there is a right issue, then you will find the theoretical X rights price, which is a weighted average price. Find the right adjustment factor, that is a cum rights price or fair value prior to rights upon theoretical X rights price. Use that rights adjustment factor multiplied to all the shares that are taken prior to the date of rights to find the value. This is to incorporate the hidden rights element. If you look at diluted EPS will also, it is the worst possible EPS considering potential equity shares like convertible preference shares, convertible debentures, contingent shares, options, warrants as the case may be. While doing so, you have to remember that you add back preference dividend, add back interest, net of tax, options, if there are any fair value changes, you do that. Contingent shares, nothing. In the denominator, the respective shares, just that in the options, you will take the free element. That is the shares issued minus the options into exercise price divided by the average fair value. In contingent shares, you will include it. Sorry, there was some audio issue. Contingent shares will be included in diluted EPS in the current year. If the current year was the end of the contingency period, would these shares be included? Would these shares be issued? If yes, then they will also be included in the diluted EPS. No prior period restatement is needed for contingent shares. Remember, you will include any type of potential equity shares in the denominator only if it results in a reduction of EPS. If it does not result in a reduction of EPS, it is treated as anti-dilutive and has to be ignored. In case there are multiple, when you look at the presentation of EPS, it happens on the face of the income statement. You have to show EPS from continuing, discontinued and total operations. EPS from continuing operations is the control number. So your EPS should reduce. The EPS from continuing operations should reduce. If it increases, you will ignore that security. If there are multiple potential equity shares, you will try to find the incremental EPS, rank these multiple potential equity shares in the ascending order, and then do step-by-step working in order to calculate the EPS. So that largely takes care of the standalone EPS, though there are a lot of complexities involved over here. And probably the last standard, thank you for bearing with me, the last standard is Ind AS 108, which is on operating segments. What do you mean by operating segments? Well, these are segments which are capable of generating income or revenue, which are evaluated by the chief operating decision maker or CODM of the entity for resource allocation as well as performance evaluation, and discrete information is available. If these three conditions are satisfied, it is an operating segment. Who is the chief operating decision maker? The person or the body who is responsible for making the chief or the major operating decisions, like a CEO or a chief operating officer, etc., or an executive panel who decides that, is considered to be the CODM. What are the reports that the CODM is going to study? That is what is going to go into the operating segments evaluation. Now, when we are looking at operating segments, do I need to show everything that is shown in the CODM? Well, generally, yes. However, there's an aggregation criteria which is given, which is if the nature of products or services are similar, if the end customers, the nature of customers are similar, the manufacturing process is similar, the distribution network or channel is similar, and let us say the regulatory environment is similar, you can aggregate two categories. Like different models of a car can be seen by CODM separately. However, we can aggregate them and show together. Once the aggregation is done, we will see whether these segments are to be indeed reported separately, in which case they have to be material. And materiality happens based on the quantitative thresholds, that is segment revenue greater than or equal to 10% of the total segment revenue, segment assets greater than equal to of 10% of the total segment assets, and segment profit, ignoring the sign, to or losses greater than or equal to 10% of the higher of the absolute segment profit or absolute segment losses, whichever is higher. Also, while calculating segment revenue, you have to ensure that you take the segment revenue internal and external both. You might be needed to prepare a detailed segment report where you will have to show the segment revenue internal, external separately, segment result, and a reconciliation of the segment result with your overall segment profit, segment assets and liabilities, and a reconciliation of those segment assets and liabilities with the overall segment assets and liabilities. And in case there are multiple segments, then giving that data for a geography as well, let's say revenue geography wise, profits geography wise, and capital expenditure geography wise. You don't have to show reconciliations in that secondary segment. However, you will need to show the detailed reconciliations in primary segment. Additionally, in primary segment, you also have to give details about capital expenditure, depreciation, and major customers dependency to the extent possible. If you do not have any segment, you'll have to give a note which says, since the entity does not have any segment, no separate segment report is, it operates in a single geography and single business, no separate segment report is made. Thank you very much for bearing with me. I really hope I've done justice. And I mean, it was a very, very quick session. Some of this ऊपर से क्या रहेगा, थोड़ा बहुत भी अगर आपने पकड़ लिया तो आई वुड बी ग्रेटफुल एंड आई वुड थिंक दैट दिस एफर्ट हैज रियली मेड सेंस. दिस दीज नोट्स, आई मीन देयर इज नो पॉइंट रेफरिंग दीज नोट्स बिकॉज दिस इज जस्ट अ यूनिट ओवरव्यू सेक्शन ऑफ द इंस्टीट्यूट मटेरियल. इफ यू वॉन्ट यू कैन रेफर इट फ्रॉम द इंस्टीट्यूट यूनिट ओवरव्यू, देयर इज नथिंग मच ओवर हियर. बट अदर देन दैट आई विश यू ऑल द वेरी बेस्ट, होप यू डू वेल. All our prayers are with you and I'm sure you will do very well. All the very best. Good luck. Goodbye. Take care.